Well, our special guest on Left, Right and Center tonight is Upinder Singh, historian and author who's just out with her new book, Political Violence in Ancient India. This is a book that essentially, as Upinder Singh says, talks about the myth of non-violent ancient India that was in part created by leaders like Mahatma Gandhi and Jawaharlal Nehru. It is quite an exhaustive book, more than 500 pages. And Upinder Singh, many congratulations for coming out with this, and it's quite a voluminous book. First, tell us very simply what it's about. And you know, people immediately sit up and take notice on the jacket of your book when you say that Gandhi and Nehru created this myth of non-violence in our history, helped create it.
Well, the book is about ancient India. It's about ancient Indian political thought, and it's also political history. I've been interested in the history of ideas for a very long time. I think it's a neglected area. And what I wanted to show was how over 1200 years, between 600 BCE and 600 CE, how politics, how kingship, how the state evolved, and how political ideas, especially ideas related to violence and non-violence, how they developed over time.
And what you're essentially saying is that it's a myth that has been built up over a period of time that we have had a non-violent past, that it's actually been a very violent past and it's always been like that. For all these years?
Well, you know, there are a lot of myths about ancient India in general. I find that everybody has an opinion, sometimes very strong views on what was happening in ancient India. And I think it's really important that people start trying to think critically and analytically about our early past. I do want to say that Gandhi and Nehru were not naive. They had a very good understanding and grasp of Indian history, including ancient Indian history. I think what they were trying to do was to emphasize non-violence against the background of a freedom struggle that was based on non-violence. So they did not create a myth. I think it is an impression that has been conveyed largely due to the importance of non-violence in our freedom struggle and also certain writings about early India, including Nehru's discovery of India, that India had a very deep connection with non-violence. I do think that Indian civilization does have a very important connect with non-violence, but that does not mean that we were a non-violent people. In fact, if you think of Ashok, if you think of the Buddha, if you think of Mahavir, and you think of the great emphasis on non-violence in their writings, in their thought, it wouldn't make sense unless they were living in an environment which was marked by intense violence.
Why do you think, though, that that has happened, that even, one part of it is about ancient India, but even our colonial history, that we like to believe that it was non-violent, that this was a non-violent freedom struggle, when in actual, it really wasn't. It was both, wasn't it?
That's true. The freedom struggle itself was a very complex phenomenon. I think that over time, we haven't really thought enough about the violence in our history. And it's become the idea of a non-violent, tolerant India has become a kind of mask that we wear, which makes us feel very good about ourselves. But I think it's very important to confront not only the wonderful aspects of our past, but also the ugly aspects. And there are both.
Well, the other thing is, and you've alluded to that, is this sort of myth-making about ancient India, about our texts. And I think one of the things that comes across is that people really haven't read our ancient texts and really, I think many people just rely on, again, myths and sort of folklore, and there's no real study of what these texts are trying to say.
That is true. Many of the texts that I've talked about in this book, for instance, I've talked about the Mahabharata, the Ramayana, I've talked about Kalidasa's works, Bhasa, the playwright, I've looked at Buddhist and Jain texts and inscriptions, etc. A lot of this material is actually available in translation, not only in English, but Hindi and other languages. And I think it's extremely important that people try to engage with these texts because they're much more interesting than what historians write, frankly. The Mahabharata, for instance, is such a rich text in terms not only of its very dramatic storyline, but in terms of its reflection on the most important issues in life, including the problem of violence, the problem of war, for instance.
And I mean, you've quoted, for instance, about how the Bhagavad Gita mentions non-violence as a list of virtues that comprise knowledge, but that it's also emphatic in inserting that an excess of predilection for non-violence is disastrous for a king.
That is true. The Mahabharata in general and the Gita do actually engage very directly with the problem of violence. And Bhishma tells Yudhishthir that, ahimsa is okay, but excessive non-violence is not something that a king can opt for. And one of the things about Yudhishthir's character is that he is a very traumatized hero. He's constantly torn between wanting to be king and wanting to run away to the forest. I think the Mahabharata is really special because it has a very powerful defense of war in particular, a very deeply complex philosophical defense of war in the Bhagavad Gita. And at the same time, it has a very powerful lament about war in the Stri Parva, when after the war, the women and the survivors assemble and they ask themselves, what was it all about and why did it happen?
Why is all of this, according to you, relevant to the times we live in today? Why are these questions important for us, or these issues important for us to understand, given the way India is today and where we are now?
Well, I'm a historian of ancient India. So when I write my history, I look at my sources, I analyze them. I'm not thinking about the present at that point of time. But while writing the book, I did certainly feel that there is an importance to this issue. And we see the violence all around us, and it occurs at various levels. I think what this book explains is that violence is an inherent part of all states, that the problem of political violence was recognized and taken very seriously by ancient Indian intellectuals, poets, religious leaders. And on the one hand, you have a justification and a celebration of violence. The fact that violence seems so invisible at times, you just don't notice it. And on the other hand, there was always, I argue, a critique, a questioning, and a discussion and debate about what is legitimate force and when does legitimate force on the part of the state become violence.
Well, it is, like I said, a fascinating account, and certainly one that has taken you, 8 years to put together?
Yes,
that's
has.
Quite a labor of love.
That's right.
Finally, Upinder Singh, let me just end by asking you this. Your father is Dr. Manmohan Singh, the former Prime Minister of India. Is he writing anything? Is he writing his memoirs, anything about his term as Prime Minister? Are you encouraging him to?
Well, I do encourage him, but if he's writing something, I don't know about it.
It would certainly be a book that we would look forward to.
Yes.
All right. Well, Upinder Singh, thank you very much. Congratulations once again. It is called Political Violence in Ancient India. Thanks very much for joining us. We'll see you again tomorrow night.